Welcome to Issues That Matter. I'm Cynthia Pooler. My guest today is my friend Robert Maripol, and Robert and I are going to have this discussion about the January 6th hearings. So, have you been watching them at all?
Well, I have I you know at first the first couple of hearings I didn't watch. I ended up watching the summaries afterwards. You know, that you could turn on the TV and watch Talking Heads and in 15 minutes basically get the 3-hour hearing. But as the hearings went on, you know, they I mean, I think one of the things it, as that you have to look at is as a performance, as a presentation. Just forget the content for a second, but the way they presented it, the way they dealt with it, was very effective in terms of capturing people. So that by the time the third or hearing, I found myself wanting to watch it. And so for the final few hearings, I certainly watched more than I did at the beginning. But, you know, once again, I feel like I reviewed them all and have a sense of what went on. And the thing that impresses me first is what an effective job they did at producing whatever point of view they were attempting to show. And frankly, Cynthia, I was very surprised by that. I thought it was going to be boring and that, you know, one of my major criticisms of the committee was it evolved so slowly. I thought that by the time they got to these hearings, people would be, oh, we've heard this all before a million times. Who cares about this? But I don't know if you agree, but I don't think that's the way the public reacted. And I think that had a lot to do with how it was presented. You know, it's like somebody from that committee got together with a bunch of people from Hollywood or something, because again, I don't know if you agree, but do you think that were you impressed with the presentation?
I thought it was pretty good. I thought Liz Cheney was excellent in what she tried to portray. But my one question to you, and we've discussed this issue before. You know, they talked about Donald Trump and how he was so obstinate throughout this whole thing. Do you think that was Donald Trump? Or a lot of it was what was learned from Roy Cohen.
Well, that's an interesting question. I think that to go back, of course, Donald Trump talked about Roy Cohn, who was the assistant prosecutor in my parents' case, the Rosenberg case in the 1950s, and then went on to work for Senator McCarthy, and then went into private practice, and he represented Donald Trump's father, who was being sued for basically racial discrimination in his housing. You know, he kept blacks out of his housing. And Cohn basically's whole entire strategy is whatever they charge you with, you charge them with that, with the same thing, only worse. Never concede anything, never accept anything, fight every minute, and accuse the people who are accusing you of doing what they're saying you did. And he became Donald Trump, the young Donald Trump's mentor. By the way, the Trump family lost that suit. They had to, they were ruled to have discriminated against, but they admitted, you know, and there was some sort of deal they made, but they admitted no wrongdoing. So we get Trump following Roy Cohn's advice. If you're attacked as a sexual predator, well, then you're going to invent something about Hillary Clinton and the Democrats, eating children and sexually abusing children in the basement of a pizza house. You know, if you're, those I'm trying to use some of the most absurd examples, but I think from what I know of listening to Donald Trump's niece, who's a psychologist, mm-hmm. you know, talk about him, he had propensities in that direction. In other words, yes, he learned the way to deal with this from Roy Cohn, but Cohn had a very willing pupil. So I would say, you know, it's a combination of the two things.
Okay. So if Roy Cohn never stepped into the picture, do you think that Donald Trump would have the same persona that he did be in school from Roy Cohn? Would you think?
Well, you know, I think that's really hard to say. I kind of think he would have a similar persona.
Okay.
If he would be so aggressive and so, you know, if one of the things that if you've watched any of the documentaries about Roy Cohn, and there have been a couple, one of which is entitled, not by my niece, but by another filmmaker, Where's My Roy Cohn? Who's going to be my Roy Cohn, or something like that, for something that Donald Trump said when he was attacked when he first became president, that, you know, I need someone like Roy Cohn defending me. Yeah. And one of the things that you see in all of these films is that Roy Cohn believed in getting away with everything. You know, he'd go into a store, if he saw a work of art that he liked, he would, quote, buy it and then never pay for it. You know, that was the kind of thing that he and Trump followed that example. So, you know, so I think it's really hard to say whether Trump would be as bad as he is without Roy Cohn. but I don't want to say that he wouldn't be bad if there were no Roy Cohn.
Wow. So what impressed you during the entire hearings, because something stands out in my mind?
Well, it's hard to pick one thing, but I think what impressed me is when you looked at the totality, when you looked at it all, you basically saw the elements of a coup. That, you know, it was, there were elements of this is the gang who couldn't shoot straight, trying to figure out what they were doing. But if you look at how it was put together, what the plans were, I think it's become clear that Trump knew that, you know, that Trump was determined to stay in office. He didn't care whether he won or not, but he knew the only way he was going to be able to pull this off was to claim fraud, massive fraud. Mm-hmm. And even though he knew it, and I think the committee showed quite clearly, he knew that wasn't the case, and then go through all these different plans to get the election overturned. And when each one didn't work, he fell back to another one. And the final one was, of course, January 6th. And it was, you know, I think that it was so clearly set out point by point. What I think is still missing is all what we find the committee being most careful about and seemingly most reluctant to deal with is their fellow members of Congress. Those people in Congress who facilitated Trump's plan, you know, without their support, Trump could have done absolutely nothing. And they have been mentioned, but none of them have been subpoenaed. And we are, because the committee took so long to get to this point, mm-hmm. If they're subpoenaed, they will, of course, fight their subpoenas. And I doubt that any of them will be forced to testify before the election.
Mm-hmm.
And then if Republicans take control of the House, which is a distinct possibility after the election, the committee will be disbanded. And so they'll never be forced to testify. So this is a big concern, because these are really the you know, there's Trump on top, but the lieutenants, not just the cockamamie lawyers he hired to come up with all these theories, and not just the people he put into the bureaucracy, like the inspector general in charge of dealing with the Secret Service, you know, not only those people, but the members of Congress have to be. And what's ironic about this is there's a law on the books that would prevent those people from being members of Congress because they participated in an insurrection. And so it's really clear. And yet that's where they seem to be unable to go. And if they're unable to go there, I don't know that the committee's revelations are going to solve the problem.
Okay. Couple of questions. Do you think if Donald Trump didn't have Giuliani or other people surrounding him, do you think he had the smarts enough to put this all together by himself?
No, I don't think so. I mean, and it's not only the smarts. I mean, I think Donald Trump can be pretty shrewd, okay? But he doesn't seem to have the ability to organize these things by himself. He has to have other people do it for him.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, he spouts off these big ideas, and then it's up to A, B, C, and D, his underlings, to make them happen, to put the pieces together. But because, and here's his downfall, because he surrounds himself with yes people who for their first priority is to be loyal to him,
mm-hmm.
That becomes more important than their competence. And the result is that he's not surrounded by particularly competent people. So when he tells the incompetent people to effectuate his plans, which have been generated in part by what incompetent people have been telling him, they end up effectuating incompetent plans. So you have a series of absolutely ridiculous lawsuits. And then you have a plan to take over the government with several hundred Proud Boys and Oath Keepers it's when you think about the Civil War and in some ways this entire what we're having here remains a reverberation of the Civil War and slavery and the end of slavery, despite the fact that it's 160 years after the end of the Civil War. When you think about what it took for the South to secede and what they engineered, and you compare that to January 6th, you know, January 6th looks like laughable incompetence. And that is a reflection of, I'm not necessarily Trump's smarts, but just his entire personality. You see this over and over again in with authoritarian leaders who only want to be told yes. The people who they end up hiring to effectuate their desires are not necessarily very competent.
Okay, let's go back for 1 second to the Watergate break-in.
Uh-huh.
If the perpetrators did not put tape on that door, mm-hmm. Watergate would probably never have been detected, mm-hmm. right?
That's quite possible.
That's pretty incompetent.
Yes. Yes, well, you know, and you know, again, that's a sign of incompetence. I think that incompetence, you know, the incompetence comes, is more complicated than just having surrounding yourself with yes men, as I said. It also involves people who have had such privilege that they think they can get away with anything. Mm-hmm. That essentially they've gotten to the place they are through manipulation, through deception, and they become extremely arrogant and they think that they can do anything and get away with it because they have before. So I think you have these two, and I think they actually reinforce each other. They're almost like positive feedback mechanisms. The you know, loyalty to Trump and doing whatever he wants, coupled with this sense that we know how to play the system. We are the privileged ones in the system. We can get away with it. We claim to be for law and order, but therefore that means we know we can be above the law. And so I think there is that sense of, it's just like we're never going to get caught because of who we are. So we can do anything we want. And that generates incompetence too, because it generates overconfidence.
Mm-hmm. So we're almost up to the midterms, and there's talk of the Republicans taking over and getting the majorities. And then, you know, we'll be looking at 2024. Okay, you and I have discussed the how ineffectual Biden's been.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so do you think that all of these hearings is a way to get around the Democrats' ineffectiveness in governing and getting candidates who can really articulate the issues?
I think that it's a step in the right direction, okay? I actually think that, well, there's no way of knowing what's going to happen in August, September, and October in terms of, you know, the political currents, the ebb and flow of things. But I would say right now in July, as I look at it, I think the Senate is going to remain Democratic. In fact, I think there's a pretty good chance, because of the incompetent candidates that the Republicans have nominated in places like Georgia and Pennsylvania, that I think that the Senate is going to remain in Democratic hands. We'll see if that's the case. I wouldn't be surprised if they picked up a couple of seats. The House, I mean, it's hard to say. It really is hard to say. It certainly seems like a much greater chance of the Republicans taking over. And I don't know, you know, aside from the fact that the House will start holding hearings on the persecution of the January 6th tourists. But other than that, I'm not sure what the impact of, if the Democrats continue to hold the Senate, they continue to hold the levers for the Supreme Court, and various judicial appointments. So I'm not quite sure if the Democrats manage to squeeze through this second big bill that, you know, is now on the table, mm-hmm. that they will not have, you know, that there really is, what's going to happen if the Republicans take over any one of the chambers is, it's whatever is done in the second half of Biden's first term is going to be through executive action. And Biden has been very reluctant to engage in executive action, just like Obama was. Mm-hmm. But we noticed in the second half of his second term, he was more active in doing that. I don't know if that's going to be the case with Biden. And we also don't know, you know, Biden will be 81 in 2024. Right. And, you know, I think there's a general feeling among Democrats that we should be able to come up with a better candidate, but no one knows who that candidate is. And Biden isn't about to, you know, turn aside. So I don't know where that's going, but I'm not confident that it's going to go in a good direction.
It looks as though Trump might be the nominee for president in 2024. And the rematch of Biden and Trump. I wish I was Rip Van Winkle. I want to sleep through that one.
Yeah, I mean, that's the thing. It is. You look at that and you say, you know, are people going to hold their noses or what are they going to do? I mean, it's. I also think the January 6th committee has really hurt Trump. I think there are a growing number of Republicans who say, I think it would be better to have someone who articulates the same policies without his baggage. And if that occurs, and there's a, you know, a battle for the Republican nomination, and Trump gets shunted aside, I think that hurts the Republicans substantially, because I don't think people like DeSantis or other have the kind of cult following that, you know, the talking heads may like them better. The people on Fox News may like them better. But in terms of the loyal Trumpies who are going to vote for him, they're not going to have the same feeling about that guy. And so I think the Republicans, and I think if there's a battle for the nomination, Trump's been weakened enough. So I think the Republicans are going to have a hard time winning the presidency in 2024.
Okay, you just said the important phrase, weakened enough. Mm-hmm. I believe that the Democrats are doing this to weaken Trump, mm-hmm. but at the same time, they're not doing much to become a viable party to Trump.
Well, I mean, you know, the Democrats are composed of a coalition that it's a house divided against itself.
Okay.
You've got the corporate Democrats who remain in control, and then you have the anti-corporate Democrats.
Who? AOC and Bernie? Who else?
And Liz Warren and the squad, you know, you have those folks, but they are, and the question, and they've been gaining ground. Okay. And it's those folks, the Bernie AOC wing, who can energize the young people, but they don't have any control. So the young people are going to stay home because what have the corporate Democrats offered them? We can't even get student loan forgiveness.
Right.
What you find is the Biden folks, the Biden wing people, the corporate wing people are banking on suburban women and Roe v. Wade and centrists to put them over the top against the Republicans. Mm-hmm. But in the meantime, all the young people are going to sit on their hands.
Right.
And people like me are going to sit on their hands because, you know, how can someone like Biden excite me? I mean, you talked about going to sleep during the election, and I can sympathize with that. Mm-hmm. So I think that what may be telling in the future is I want to see within the Democratic Party how the Bernie AOC wing of the Democratic Party does in this election. Mm-hmm. Are there more of them or are there less of them? you know, and that's that, I, you know, because it seems to me that's the wave of the future, because it's where the young votes are coming from.
And I also want to see what happens to Liz Cheney. If she loses the election, well, I don't think she's going to quietly go away. I think that's going to propel her for something bigger than the House, right?
Well, I, you know, my feeling about Liz Cheney is what I'd like Liz Cheney to do was to form something called the New Republican Party or the Real Republican Party and actually run for president. Mm-hmm. With some other candidate, in an effort to split, you know, basically realizing that if she does that, she will hand the Democrats the presidency.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know what's in her head. I don't know whether she's willing to do that because, you know, I mean, one of the things that's weird about this, Cynthia, is, you know, she's coming out as this big hero.
Mm-hmm.
And she's no great big hero. I mean, if you look at her, you know, yes, she's shown some integrity. She's shown some honesty in this. But if you look at her positions, you know, they're not much better than Trump's in terms of her positions. And then you know, the other person who's coming out as a hero is, of all people, Mike Pence, you know, who's a theocrat, you know, he believes in a religious government. You know, he's as, you know, despite not, you know, his willingness to, his refusal to break the law and create a constitutional crisis on January 6th, you know, he's as close to a Christian nationalist as you can get. I mean, he is, and yet he's being portrayed as heroic. Well, you know, that's kind of nauseating. I mean, on the one hand, you recognize that there are people who have terrible politics who also have some integrity, which is a hard thing to admit. It's true, they have some integrity, but that doesn't make their politics any better. And that doesn't make what they want to have done to the United States any better. So, you know, it's troubling to me that we, you know, the whole Democratic policy of the committee, which is to have almost every one of their witnesses be a Republican, so that the committee is definitely, you know, showing, you know, Republicans against Republicans. It's still making a segment of Republicans into heroes.
Mm-hmm.
And that's very troubling.
And on that note, we've got to close for the day, and I hope that you and I we'll have ongoing discussions as this goes on. So you've been listening to Robert Maripol. I'm Cynthia Pooler. This is Issues That Matter. And if you like this show, please subscribe to my YouTube page. Thank you, Robert. Thank you, everybody, for listening. Have a great day.